got to give from the 29 of us that went to the Dominican Republic to serve and to let the people there know about the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I just want to give you a quick overview, then we're going to show a video, and then the kids are going to have an opportunity to say a few words about what the trip meant to them. But we left a couple weeks ago on a Tuesday. We did a three-day sports camp up in the northern part of the country, a little town called Ebert. And then Saturday and Sunday, we traveled back down to the center of the country where Michelle lives and works, Navarrete. And Saturday, we served the church, Sunday as well. And then we did another three-day sports camp there in Navarrete, and before we had a fun day and came home. So you're going to see a lot of, I want to let you know what you're going to see, so that when you see it, you'll understand a little bit. But again, God showed up. It was wonderful how we were able to serve and to help and to lead and to encourage the church that's there. So without me saying any more, let's go ahead and turn it over to the video.
The fiends of earth are teeming in the light of your glory and grace. I'll set the signs upon heaven. I'm fixing my eyes on
two main reasons. One is I see how greatly it impacts the church over there, how encouraged they are by our coming, and how much we're able to do great things. Churches that normally have 50 or 60 people show up on a Sunday, we can have, you know, 300 or 400 show up for a sports camp, and then an additional 100 show up for a Bible school that we do that night. And we didn't have a whole lot of pictures of the worship services. Each night of sports camp, we have a time where we invite the community to come hear a band and a rap artist and a preacher to come out, and we'll have 400 or 500 people show up for these events, but it's always completely dark. In a country with no electricity at night, the videos don't show up so well, so we don't get to show you guys what I call the payoff. The reason we do sports camps all day is so that we can tell them and their mom and dads, uncles and neighbors about Jesus Christ. So that's for me, that the payoff is we could tell the Dominican people about, but also I've never seen anything in youth ministry that impacts kids as much as a foreign mission trip. We take kids away from the country and we bring them back. They're totally different people. And so I just thank you guys for giving us the opportunity every year to continue to change lives and impact people, not just in our community, but around the world. So anyway, they're going to take about a minute each and tell you how the trip affected them and what they got out of it. So thank you guys again for being here.
I just want to talk briefly about the worship. One thing that stood out to me was when we had Sunday morning worship. I didn't know if you could see in the video where Kelsey and I were singing, but Michelle was back there. He was just worshiping. And that was every song. They just have a freedom of worship that was just so attractive to me. And even though I couldn't understand what they were saying, the Holy Spirit was the same. It's the same language. And it moves the same way over there, and I was bawling like a baby during the service. It was just so impactful to me. So the freedom of worship over there and just the Holy Spirit moving was tremendous to me.
Okay, I'm going to talk about hospitality. And they make us feel at home every day. I know the house that I stayed in, there were like 7 people in the house, and they all shared one bed, so Alyssa, Keena, and I could each have our own bed. And I know I was walking around without shoes one day just in the house, and the mom came up to me and took off her shoes and made me put on her shoes to walk around the house. I also know at our sports camp, we didn't have bathrooms, so we would just go up to a random house and knock on the door, and we would use anybody's bathroom. So, yeah.
I'm talking about our worship service that we had in Pontone, which is the second place we lived. At the service, RALA, which is the rap star that they get so excited about, happened to be at this concert. And Aaron and I got the opportunity to sing The Great I Am in Spanish and English. And one of the great things about this is that you never know what's going to happen. And right before we were going to sing, Cassie, which is Melchor's wife, walks up to me and says, I'm going to sing with you guys. And during the song, I remember thinking, this sounds awful. This is a mess. I was singing in Spanish, she was singing in English, and Cassie didn't know really what she was singing. She was switching back and forth. And I was thinking, this is chaos. And afterwards, Dan came up to me and said that was really beautiful. The Dominicans really appreciated that you sang in their language. And it just hit me that we get so caught up with, oh, do I sound okay? Am I on pitch? And is he on pitch? Are we on the same pitch? And they're not worried about that. They're worried about worshiping God. And that just hit me between the eyes, because that's what we should be worried about. And then I also had a friend named Alex, who was the little redhead on the screen that none of you recognized, and she went with us this year, and she just sent a brief message that she just wanted me to read to you guys. First, I want to say thanks to everyone for allowing me to go on this trip. It was such a blessing to be able to travel to the Dominican. My favorite part was speaking to them in their own language. It was difficult to overcome the language barrier, but there's nothing that compares when a child would finally understand what their eyes would light up and they would turn and explain to their friends. It was truly an amazing experience and something that has changed me forever. And she wanted me to tell you that she misses all of you guys so much, and she was crying when she sent me this.
I'm going to talk about the food there and the selflessness of the ladies. There are ladies that would cook 3 meals a day back to back, and they would love to do it. And all the food never had like chemicals or preservatives, and there was fruit everywhere. There's no way you could go hungry, because you could just walk down the street and pick fruit off any tree. And people would just, the kids would sell it for extra money, and everybody would buy them, especially Lumencias, because we all love them and they don't have them here. And it was a great trip, and I wanted to thank everybody that supported me, and I can't wait till next year.
I'm going to talk about the worship, but Aaron and Kelsey summed up most of it. Even though we don't speak the same language, that wasn't a barrier for us. It was just as powerful, even though I didn't understand the Spanish part. And I know it was the same for them when we were singing in English.
All right, I'm going to talk briefly about the honoring. Every night we would have a group time just among the group. And then once we would do praise and worship, and then we'd do a short lesson, we'd gather everyone around, and someone would sit in the middle of a circle of all of us, and a couple people would just say something nice and wonderful about that person in the middle. And we would do 3 or 4 people a night, and then we have the honor books so that we don't forget what they say, because I know I forget everything. So I'm glad I have a little book to reference back every once in a while.
I'm going to talk about how it feels to get honored. It's kind of intimidating going up there and sitting in the big circle of people and wondering what they're going to say about you. But whenever you hear the things that people have to say about you, it brings so much joy to you. And it just shows how much faith and how much people really do love you on this trip. And then after people go through and honor you, you get in a big circle, or they come up and they put their hand on you and they bless you. Prayer, and it's just amazing, because you come back and you really truly are blessed from this trip.
I'm going to talk about testimonies, and correct me if I'm wrong, but Doug, Maria, myself, Andrew, Megan, Kia, Courtney, and Alex all gave testimonies this year. And like, it makes me really happy when I see those go up there that have been on the trip many years, because you can see them finally opening up and going out of their comfort zone. And mine this year was over like my biggest problem, which is gossip. And so I asked for forgiveness in front of like 200 Dominicans and like the 30 Americans, and of course God. And I promised to stop gossiping, and that whatever came out of my mouth would be pleasing to God. And I also asked that if anyone felt called to stand up and join me while I prayed, so we could like embark on the journey together. And at first I was scared to look up when I got done praying, but when I looked up, the entire church was standing. So it really.
Okay, I'm going to talk about the special Tuesday night church service we had, which was the first concert in Navarrete. We had the concert, which the band performed a few songs, and then Rachel, Courtney, and Andrew gave their testimonies. And then the sermon started, and about halfway through, you saw the line of Dominicans just standing up in front of the pastor. They were giving their lives to God. That was such an amazing thing to witness, just because you can say, hey, I was there. I got to see these people change their lives, and it was amazing. Like, there's no way I can set it into words.
I am talking about the generosity of the Dominican people. It is unreal how generous they are. It is nothing like any of us have ever seen. They never close their doors, ever. Never. Like, you just walk into their house and you could just talk to them if you want to. Like Kia was saying with the bathrooms, you just went up to the bat or their door and asked them if you could use the bathroom. Of course, they don't know what you're saying, but I mean, you just walk in and they're like, opa, and you're like, hi. But they're just so generous. Like, the children, they have so little, and the children are so willing to give you stuff, like bracelets. They'll just come up and give you bracelets. Like, they're not asking for anything in return. Like, even the meals, like, they make 3 meals a day, and they go last in line. It's amazing how generous they are, just loving.
I'm going to talk about dance force camps in the mountains, and we went there, and we got there, and all the kids are running around playing basketball, and they're just shooting and having a good time. And then when they see us, they come running up to us and say hola. And we got the teams. We taught for 2 days, and then on the third day, we let them play against each other. And I coach the orange team, and I don't know any Spanish, so I'm using all hand motions. And the kids understood. And what really got me in the mountains is when I was coaching, I had a break, and my team wanted a picture, so I got to take the picture. And one kid said, no, come here, we family. And that really got to me right there. And then, like, after the day 3 of the sports camp, they made a drill team to perform for us. And it took like months and months to prepare. And it was really nice to see the kids that were watching get into it, and the kids that performed for us did really good.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about beach day. And so we got there, and you'd be walking down the beach, and people would just walk out of their stores and say, come here, come here, come here, come here, come here. I have something for you. And there was this one store, and there was a Christian guy who owned it. Just for us, he would drop the price halfway. And whenever we'd walk in there, he'd greet us so kind. Everybody down there is so nice. I never really thought the religion was this widespread.
Okay, so I'm going to take a minute and talk about the transportation. Let me first start off by saying the ratio of motorcycles to cars is like 3 to 1. We mostly drove around, as you saw in the video, the 15-passenger van that they fit almost 40 Dominicans in. and we got like a top of like 20 Americans in there. So, and then we also drove around the big 20-something passenger bus, 24 passenger bus, and yeah, basically it was like more like motorized transportation. I only saw a couple of horses and that kind of stuff. And they put like four people on a motorcycle once and a mattress. It was pretty sweet.
I'm gonna talk about showers. They had a state-of-the-art, newly installed filtration system. It was a men's Hane, size 8 through 12, crew sock. Newly installed. And last year, they built a shower and bathrooms for us inside the church. Who needs a shower in a church? But we were to stay there for 10 days, so they built it for us. And Mel Chor can build anything. He put light in there just by 100 foot of extension cord and hooked up a light to it. Shower was fine. You had to walk down a mountain to get to it. It was this cement box that you showered in that was about this tall. I had to be on a knee to get in.
I'm going to talk about our Dominican helpers. For the last 3 years I've been down there, and we've had the same five or six guys that always, I mean, the women always cook for us, and they've already talked about that. We always have five or six guys that are with us at all times, and never at any time have I felt unsafe in the Dominican, primarily because those guys are with us. You got Osoki, Manny, Frank, Wilson, of course, Michelle, Major, who? Henry was a new face this year, and Jody, of course, which is Major and Cassie's son, who speaks fluent English, was over here, and he was a big asset to us. But everywhere we go, they wait on us. These guys that drive the buses and the vans, they're waiting on 29 Americans to try to get organized and to get on two vehicles, which they could fit their entire neighborhood in one. But I mean, we're dragging basketballs and all this other stuff, and they're always smiling and happy to serve us, and they're always watching out for us too. You, every once in a while you'll see them go over and talk to somebody, and then somebody will leave or come back, but they always took care of our water. So without those five or six guys spending 10 days with us, we would have failed miserably. There's no way we could have gotten it done. So I mean, they kept us in water, and a lot of these guys, three of the six I know, were out of work. So we were trying to give them a little bit of money too. I know Michelle would give them a little bit of money too for them to come over and help us, but it was only successful because of those guys.
Okay, I'm going to talk about Cassie and Major. They keep moving back and forth from the Dominican to America, trying to raise their five kids. But they're probably the most amazing people I've met besides our other missionaries down there. But Cassie is one of our translators, and she is amazing when it comes to VBS because she's really good with kids. So when she would translate for us and we'd have VBS, I remember she would get really into the songs, and she would do more with them than we would normally do, and it was beautiful to see her interacting with the kids down there because she was so good at it. And then Major, like other people have said, he kind of did a little bit of everything. He would build things, fix things, do whatever we needed him to do, and he drove the bus like a maniac. But they're just, it's so encouraging to see people like them because they're so selfless, and they're, everything that they want to do is serve. Like, they want to serve God and serve others, and that's their primary goal in life, and I thought that was beautiful.
Well, I'm going to talk about Michelle and Sahades, which is our missionary and his wife, and I every time I think about Sahades, I think of 45 people coming for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and you're fixing it for 6 days. What a service. And her mother helped along with another lady, but I think of what I would do in America if I knew I was going to have 45 people, three meals a day. and have to make sure I had something for him to eat. And that's tremendous. That's a service that, as I tell Sahini's every meal, it's just gracias for fixing it, because it takes a lot of her time and everything, but to give up her time and everything. And then, of course, Michelle, I remember Billy, when he went with us, came back and said, "Dad, we don't pay him enough." He still does so many things for us. Our trip was successful because of him, and all the things he knows and all the people he knows. And this, with having Mature and Cassie back, has taken a little bit of a load off of him, I think, a little, because he has more help. He also has one of the Dominican guys now helping him with his church. He's finally developing, and we talked about this, leaders, Dominican, other Dominican men and women to help out. And that's such a blessing for him. It's also a blessing for us in our church. We have great sisters and brothers in Christ there, in the Dominican, in Mature, and on. And our, I don't know if you know what our shirts actually say in Spanish, but it's John 1:12. "Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." And that's the thing we try to do every day that we're there. And with the help of Mature, Cassie, Michelle, and Sahadis, every year I keep thinking it can't get better, but it gets better. And this group is, all of them were tremendous for the 10 days we were there. I just have one other real quick thing. Yesterday, the David Lipscomb University women's basketball team left Nashville and is going to where we were in Pontoon. They're staying in the church, and they are building a basketball court. So I've just asked for your prayers for them, because they have some people who've never traveled out of the U.S. Remembers this team. I corresponded with their coach right before they left, and they were looking forward to it, but also a little apprehensive as to them. So I just asked for us to keep them in our prayers this week, because for them, it's the first time. And we've all been there. We all know it's great, but they have to learn it for themselves.
For VBS, we had games, music, puppets, a lesson, crafts, and the snacks. And for games, when we were in the mountains, we took them out into the dirt road and we played red light, green light, and Simon Says. They got a kick out of that. They liked it. And for music, everybody was standing up and doing all the hand motions and all this stuff you did with the songs. Puppets, I couldn't really see, but I heard that they were having a good time watching. And the lesson, we had some good lessons from the people, and kids came up and dressed up and reenacted what the lesson was about. And for crafts, we made some crafts while we were in Seymour, but when we got there, we gave them supplies and everybody went around helping them out. And for snacks, it was while they were leaving, they just passed out the snacks while they were leaving, and everybody left happy.
Accommodations-wise, I don't know what you expect when you go on a vacation, but I've been on other missions trips, so I kind of knew what to expect. But you need to understand that the people are opening their homes, and so for the women, most of the accommodations were families from churches taking numerous people in. And like was said earlier, the whole family would sleep in one room so that other people could share the other bedrooms. For the guys, it was... in the mountains, there's a school across from Mator's parents' house, and we slept on the floor. Kind of everybody had a mattress pad on the floor, and then if you brought an air mattress, or you could get a second mattress pad, a foam pad about that thick. And we gathered together. It definitely is a bonding experience. Sleeping on the floor, and some of the guys learned that I have a spider ward off, inside internal ward off thing. I snore, and therefore the spiders stay away. So, you know, they may not appreciate it, but I didn't have any spiders on me. So, we did have a few guests in our, there were wolf spiders and there were lizards, and then outside the windows there's chickens. So you get the full effect when you're there. And then when we were in Navarrete, we stayed in the top of the church, in one of Michel's churches. And that was nice. Not so many spiders, not so many lizards, lots more chickens outside. And they would land, there's a metal roof over the top, and the chickens would land on the roof and fight each other, and it's pretty cool. So I was up at about 6 o'clock every morning, whether I wanted to be or not. It's just that time I got up, and it was amazing. They have gone the distance for us. We look at it as maybe less than our expectation, but for them, it's giving everything they have to accommodate us. So we really appreciate it.
Bear with me, I have a sinus infection. Something that I got to experience personally while on the trip was Cassie had asked our group early on in the trip, does anyone know how to draw blood? And going to nursing school, partially, I had done that before and working in hospital. So I just thought it was neat. We were only there with a few days, and I got to experience something like that. There was a lady that had a stroke, and the doctor was just doing some lab work on her just to follow up, and I got to help her, and it was special to me as well because, my grandpa just passed away from a stroke, and so that was really special that I got to help someone in his condition, so thank you.
Okay, we're going to have question and answer here in a second, but before we do that, does anybody in the group think of something that you wish you would have said but you forgot or you just thought of something?
Andrew and Noah couldn't make it today, so I'm going to talk about the sports camps in Navarrete. In Navarrete, we, at the beginning of the week, Donna's group had a difficult group, I guess. They'd never been to a sports camp and had a hard time like listening to us and like didn't really understand like what we were trying to tell them. So it was a blessing when we went to Navarrete, and those children were literally angels. It was amazing. They listened to everything we tell them to do, and they were just awesome. They would, like, we'd ask them to do something, and all of them would do it right when we said it the very first time. It was just amazing how well they just obeyed and listened, and yeah. Yeah, they were excited to do it. It was great.
One thing that never seems to make it on the list of things that we're going to talk about is the sponsors. And I'm assuming that's because Dan has this amazing sense of humility. And they're totally amazing. We had Aaron and Dan and Doug, Kina, Morgan, Donna, Jason, yep. Maria Hosberger. She's a wonderful woman that isn't here this morning. But they are truly amazing. Whether they know Spanish or not, they try to communicate with little kids. They try to instruct us. They have to live with us for 10 days in close quarters. And even when emotions get high and we are all just going crazy, they somehow keep us in line. And I just want to thank them for all they did for us. There were times when we didn't show the appreciation we should have just because we were all going crazy with so many things on our mind. But you guys were truly amazing, and we couldn't have done this trip without you guys.
And we'll have question and answer here in a second, but I did forget, Maria, one of the sponsors that were with us this year, she's this week on a personal vacation, and she filmed a short video that she wanted to have shown.
Hi, I'm Maria, and a couple days before the Dominican Republic trip, Dan asked us how we were hoping God would reveal himself during our trip, and I just said I was looking forward to some God sightings, some little miracles. Well, a couple weeks before the trip, I decided to purchase on Amazon an English Bible that I could take with me and feel free to carry it around and get dirty and not worry about it. Well, I packed it around for 2 weeks down there, and on the last day, the day before we left, I asked Michelle if he would need my English Bible, and he said, yeah, I have a girl that was needing an English Bible. And I thought it was so cool, because if he'd asked Dan before, Dan would probably have brought the English Bible. with him on the trip, but God knew when I made that purchase that he had a special plan for that.
Okay, I think she went on to say for that Bible. And that was about all. It was about 40 seconds, so that was about all we had. Hey, I'm sure we didn't answer every question that people here had for the team. So team, I want you to stay right where you're at. When we're done, I do want you to go back in case people want to talk to us individually. We'll greet by the door. But for now, stay where you're at. Did you guys have any, and we'll let whoever seems to be the expert on that question be the one that answers it. But what questions did you all have for the team about this year's trip? Okay, at the beach, how deep in the water did they go? I think Sam's probably the expert on that one. Just speak loudly. My boy can hold his breath for about 3 to 4 minutes, so he's gone until his ears bleed and then he comes back up. Yeah, that's the beach. We do that just the last day only because, you know, when God's created, he knew the last day it was a good thing to rest. So we work for 9 days, and then on the 10th day we rest. And that, for Indiana kids, that seems to be the best place in their country for us to go and rest. Actually, how many kids had never seen the beach except in the Dominican Republic? Okay, so God's been able to bless some of them with an experience. Other questions? Yeah, their school schedule is based on the United States model. So they go August to about May or the early June. So when we're there in the summers, there's no school, which is a blessing because we typically use their school facilities for our sports camps. So, and actually, I know they go back August 18th because that was mentioned to us, you know, in case we were going to be able to help the kids again this year, have the outfits and the stuff that they use to go to school. Yes, ma'am. How many horses do they have? Yes.
Not very many, I would say. But one day at the camp, I did see, like, our camp was, like, in this, like, little building thing. And then there were houses on the back road, and there was, like, this, like, dirt road. And one day there was, like, this just line of horses all pulled together by a rope, just running. And it's turning blue. Like, there was one guy at the front, like, riding it. And there were, like, 7 or 8 horses.
Yeah, and then I saw a couple. In the mountains, it seemed to be more prevalent where vehicles and roads are more difficult. We've seen guys ride them to work or ride, you can tell they ride them to the store because they come back and they've got like rice bags full of groceries. So we have seen some. Yes?
How is the weather and humidity over there?
The weather and humidity. Doug?
While we were there, it was about 92 to 95 degrees every day, partly cloudy during the day, so the sun beat down, and in the afternoon, storms pop up, but the main part of the town, they haven't had a lot of rain, and it only rained maybe 5 or 10 minutes, and then it was done. So it was very humid in the afternoons. At nighttime in the mountains, it probably got down to the low 60s, and in the lower parts, upper 70s at night.
Yeah, it stays pretty warm and pretty humid, honestly. So. Yes, sir.
This is for as many as want to answer, but what do you appreciate more about home after having been on the mission trip?
Okay, let me give the mic. And pass it around. We have several.
I think I can speak for all of us when I say this, but showers. And flushing toilet paper.
I appreciate that there isn't a rooster crowing for 4 hours in the morning. It doesn't sound like normal roosters. It sounds like it's like screaming at us. I just wanted them to eat it. My next
next door neighbor isn't Michael Vick's doggy daycare?
Mine was my family. I miss them a lot, so I was happy.
Mom would say the sewage, because the sewage on the side of the road, it can get pretty gross and stinks. So you'd be walking and you're on the sidewalk, make sure you don't want to step in the shoo-shoo water, as my dad calls it. And it's just everywhere.
Okay, I'm grateful that I walk down the streets and people aren't yelling at me in Spanish, and I don't know what they're saying. That's always bad.
Can we do what we're grateful for the Dominican too?
Oh yeah.
Whenever we got back to the Miami airport, me and Alyssa and Jason and Ashley went to eat ice cream, and this lady had the sink running in the back for over 5 minutes, and that just made me, I wanted to climb over the counter and turn it off because Alyssa went 4 days with a bucket of water to shower. So that's something I'm grateful for.
I would have to say that, and this is not what I would initially have thought of, but the opportunity to go on one of these trips. We're so lucky in this country that we can send out support letters and we get all the money we need. And we work at a bake sale and we get all the money we need. There's not that. There's not people just that have extra cash hanging around that can throw in a couple bucks. So just because we view them as needing missions taken to them, they have the same calling on their lives to go and make disciples of the world, not just us, not just the rich countries. So we have that opportunity to go do that, and it's easier for us to go to that foreign country, whereas for them, they're more secluded to where they are, and even to go to Haiti for them is difficult. So I would have to say that opportunity to be able to travel and spread the gospel.
Okay, I'd have to say I'm thankful for, like, traffic calls over here. Because their driving is ridiculous.
Crazy. And I've always thought, because I didn't leave America until I was 28 for the first time, and I thought I didn't really understand America until I was outside of it, of our country. And I think one thing I really appreciate is just the educational opportunities that we have. Down there, the kids probably get 6 years. They're supposed to get 6 years. And then after that, if they've got access to a high school, or you know what they call the secondary school, colegio. But a lot of kids don't. So a lot of kids are getting 10 years, if they're from a well-to-do family, probably 6 years, and in some cases, less than two or three years. So a lot of them can't read and write, so just the ability for them to change their circumstances is impossible. You know, if your dad worked in a sugar cane field and you get no education, you're going to work in a sugar cane field, and so forth. And so it's not just that in America you can, if you have the desire and the work ethic, you can change for the better your circumstances. And I think there, for some of them, it doesn't really matter how hard you work or how hard you try. You are what you are. So, yes, Doug.
Sure. The one thing I'm thankful for is that these people all have a testimony. And I don't know if they knew they had a testimony beforehand, but now they all have a testimony about going and doing and being the hands and feet of Jesus. And whether you think you would impact a life or not, you have no clue. But if you're willing to give of yourself, God uses that. So I shared many testimonies with lots of people to try to encourage a lot of what goes on, and I'm really anxious to hear testimonies coming forward.
Okay, Rachel. This has been a good question because we got everybody to.
I'm going to go with what Courtney said, what you're grateful for in the Dominican, and mine is like the feeling of like safe. I know we would get back to our houses where we were staying at the church for the guys, and it was early in the morning, like 1 o'clock, 12 before you get to bed, and you know, we'd sleep with the doors wide open, the windows open, and we would just fall right asleep, like we feel so safe. But at home we have, you know, windows locked, our doors locked, our cars locked, and
It's just like you would think in a poverty-stricken country that you would feel really dangerous, but I feel so safe there.
I am grateful for, kind of like what I talked about earlier, their generosity. They are just so caring. Nothing against America or anything, but they're just nothing like anything we have in America. They are so loving. Like, there's no stranger, no strangers at all. You're a friend with everyone. You're family with everyone. Everyone is, no one doesn't know someone. It's just amazing. And it really feels like home. I think, honestly, all of us could say that we feel more home there than we do in America. It just really feels like we're supposed to be there. Any more questions?
Okay, we'll do one more, then I want to turn it over to Pastor Bill. Can somebody speak about what the inside of the house, the typical Dominican house, is like?
Well, in the house that I sit in with Morgan and Kennedy Rehart, you walk in and then there's this little area that's probably as big as like this stage, the front part of the stage, and there's like a couch and a little table, and then there's a little desk with a computer on it. They have technology, which you would not think you would see them with phones or computers, but they actually do have that stuff. And then you walk back and there's this little tiny cramped area where there's a stove and a fridge and another table, and you barely can even get in this room. And then off to the left, they have a little bedroom that is probably about the size of the one classroom right here on the right, and that's where they stayed. And they normally don't all stay in that room, but they did this time. They had one bed, and they actually borrowed our air mattresses because they took the mattresses off of their beds, put them on our bed, and they were going to sleep on the floor. So when you go to the back part of the house, there was one more room that is about the same size as the other room, the other bedroom, and it's got a dresser and bunk beds. This family was very fortunate to actually have bunk beds. A lot of families have maybe one bed. So it's basically just a concrete block with a few divider walls in it to make some rooms, but it's very small, very cramped. Even when we aren't there, a lot of families have to sleep in the same bed or on the couch or sleep on floor mats. So dirt floors, some of them have concrete floors, but it's, don't expect to lick the floor because it's dirty, but they don't care. They see it as being privileged to have a home. So.
I'm not going if I can't lick the floor. I want to thank all the kids and all the sponsors, and I want to thank you guys. You made it possible for these folks to go. It's your $20, $25, $50 sending in support that adds up to their total cost that allows them to go. Kelsey made the comment that if we need to go on a mission trip, we raise the support and we go. And that's the wonderful thing about living in a country of blessing and bounty and favor, where we are so blessed by God to have what we have. And they're not. And every year at this time, there is the church in San Francisco, Pastor Luis's church. It's the church that you guys bought the tables and chairs to replace with brand new ones out of our Easter offering. And those are in place and being used. But at that church, the kids can't go to school. He has a school there. And the kids can't go to school unless they have shoes and school supplies and uniforms. And believe it or not, that costs about $15 a kid to provide all of that. So we take up an offering, we send that $1,500 down there so 150 kids can go to school. I'm going to ask the boys, if you guys will just go to the back and get the offering plates. After I pray, we're going to take up an offering. Please just stay seated until the offering passes in front of you. Do what you can. We're a blessed nation. We have so much. These kids won't go to school if they don't get 15 bucks to pay for their school supplies and things so that they can go. And I thank you a second time for your generosity, because not only did you send these kids, did you see your band? You
you bought out of the Easter offering a couple of years ago, a 15-passenger van, which Aaron said he counted 40 passengers that got in that van. So a 15-passenger van became a 40-passenger van. And people come back and forth to church every day because of you guys and your generosity. You're blessed. Let's give. Let's raise as much as that $1,500 as we can. Dan said the 18th, just a few weeks they'll be going. They need their supplies before they go. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the way that you have honored our church with generosity. I thank you for these kids and these sponsors and their willingness to go and bring us back the story of taking the gospel to a third world country. We look around and we realize with the statements that are made and even through the videos that we're so blessed to be a nation that has so much. We want to stop on the way home today and eat at a restaurant. That's no problem. We can do that. And yet these kids need that $15 we would spend on a meal just to go to school for a year. And so I pray that you'll lay it on our hearts here to be generous. And I thank you for the generosity of this church family. And I just pray continued relationships with the Dominican, with Michelle, and the wonderful people that we have down there, so that we never stop going and ministering to people and changing lives. We love you. Bless those who give. The Bible says that you love a cheerful giver, so I just pray that you'll bless every single person that supports this. And I pray in Jesus' name. I wanna fly.